also. So the first talk will be Domenico. He'll be talking about the geometry of random spherical eigenfunctions. So Domenico, you can start.
Okay, so can you hear me? Yes. So first thing, many thanks for inviting me to give this seminar. I must confess that I've never been to India. That's a big regret for me. I was trying to organize this trigger many times, but for some reason or some other, we never managed. And so my first time is this virtual time, but I very much hope that in the future there will be occasion to visit in person, because I would be very glad about it. Okay. So about my talk, I'm going to talk about geometry of random spherical eigenfunctions. I'm going to give an overview of some results which have been given in this area in the last basically 10 years, more or less. And so this overview is going to cover, also my joint works with other people. Most important among them are Igor Wigman, who's really the guy who sort of started this line of research around 2009. And then Valentina Cammarota and Maurizio Rossi is also here and is going to give the second talk with many more details on in particular on the nodal lines and boundary lines. Okay. I'm going to talk about eigenfunction on S2, okay, on the two-dimensional sphere. I'm going to give some conjecture for the higher dimensional spheres, whereas Maurizio is going to cover also different manifolds. So this means that we have the spherical Laplacian, which is this operator that you see down here, and then we study functions which satisfy these equations, which is known as Helmholtz equation. So there is an eigenvalue, which is actually minus LL plus one, and then there is this standard equation that you see here. Now, in this talk, I'm not going to have much time to discuss, basically no time at all to discuss motivations, but there are many. In particular, as the zero sets of eigenfunctions, even in the deterministic setting, have been studied now for nearly 200 years, starting from Chladni in the early 19th century, 1808, okay? Then, of course, eigenfunctions are extremely important in quantum mechanics. And here there is this idea by Berry, okay, Michael Berry, which basically conjectured that Gaussian randomized eigenfunctions should sort of mimic the behavior of deterministic eigenfunctions under generic boundary conditions. And because of this, there is a lot of interest in quantum mechanics in the study of random eigenfunctions, of course. Then, as I said before, actually this line of research in probability has been started around 10 years ago by Nazarov and Sodic and Wigman. The reason I came to be interested in this area is that if you're interested more generally in spherical random fields, then what happens, isotropic spherical random fields, then what happens is that you can get these random eigenfunctions as basically the Fourier components of the field. And because of this, there is a lot of interest also coming from, for instance, cosmological applications, which I will not discuss today. Okay? So in particular, what happens is that if you have a general random field, so an application which goes from some probability space times the sphere into R, okay, and this field, you take it to be Gaussian and isotropic, so invariant in law with respect to rotations, then it's a standard fact that you can view the field by means of a spectral representation as what? As a weighted sum of random eigenfunctions times some weights, which give you the so-called angular power spectrum of the field, or actually the square of them gives you the angular power spectrum. So this means that each of these components after normalization is what? It is itself a Gaussian random field with zero expected value and with a covariance that with normalization is simply given by Legendre polynomial. Okay, Legendre polynomial are defined by this. Will not be no other further problems. So here you should just remember that the derivative of this covariance at the origin, okay, is just the eigenvalue divided by two, fine? Because this is going to be important later on, fine? Now, so in our title, we said we want to study the geometry of this spherical Gaussian eigenfunction. So what does it mean? Well, okay, here, Robert Adler knows better than anybody else. The standard approach which has been taken in the last decades to study this geometry of random fields is to study the recursion sets, which are defined here. So you just have generic random field on a manifold. You look at what? You look at what? At the subset of the manifold where the field is larger than some threshold U, okay? So this is a subset of the manifold. You want to study the geometry of this subset, okay? So this is what we mean by geometry of random eigenfunctions, okay? So let me give you some examples, just some pictures. So these pictures actually are taken from cosmology, from cosmological data, by this on this so-called cosmic microwave background radiation, which, as I said, I won't discuss today. But just think of it as a Gaussian random field on the sphere, okay? Normalized to have expected value zero and variance one, okay? Then what do you do? Okay, red regions are positive red regions, blue regions are negative regions. Then you look just at the regions which are above some threshold. So the first thing that you see here is the field when you cut it at threshold minus three. Then this is a Gaussian field. As you know, if you cut it normalized with zero mean and variance one, if you cut it at minus three, basically you get back all the field. Then you go ahead, you raise the threshold, minus two, minus one, like zero. Okay, so it starts at zero. Here you see that a lot of regions have been erased, are just gray, and you just look at the regions where the field is larger than it's positive, okay? Which are these blue, I mean, these regions that you see. And then if you go higher and higher, what happens is that, of course, you get just a few isolated regions of which you want to study some geometric characteristics, okay? Now, which geometric characteristics? Well, let me give you just intuition. Pretend that the recursion region is just this square block here, okay? Just this blue square, okay? Then what you can do is to build a cube around the square. So just look at all the points, okay, that are at a fixed distance, let's say rho from the square, so from the recursion region, okay? Then what you want to study is the measure of this cube, okay? It turns out that this measure under minimal regularity condition, the measure of this cube admits a finite order Taylor expansion, and the coefficients in this Taylor expansion are some geometric functions, which are those that you are going to study. Okay, so in particular, if you look at this cube here, okay, then there is a zero order term, which is just the original square. Then there is a linear term, which I hope you see as yellow. Srikar, you see properly this picture?
Yes.
Okay, so there is this yellow region is given by what? It's given by the boundary times the length of the radius, okay? And it are these four rectangles here, okay? And then if you put together the four corners, you get the disk. And of course, the area of the disk is pi times rho square, okay? So it's a quadratic term in the radius, okay? Let's think about it as one, because you can understand easily that if I had here two squares, there would be two disks, okay? So times like the number of squares, something like this, okay? Now, this is a general phenomenon, which comes from a beautiful formula, so-called Steiner's tube formula, which tells you the following, that under this regularity condition, you have a manifold M, you build a tube of radius rho around the manifold, okay? Then you compute the measure of this tube, and you get a finite Taylor expansion in which you have n plus one terms, so m is the dimension of the manifold, okay? So if in our case, the dimension of the manifold before was two, we had three terms, which give you what? Powers of the radius, okay? Then some constant universal coefficients, which are like this that you see here, some pi's, some gamma functions, but these are universal. And then some functionals of the original manifolds, and these functionals are the so-called Lipschitz-Killing curvatures, okay? Which are those that we want to study, okay? So in particular, in the two-dimensional case, the Lipschitz-Killing curvatures are what? Well, what I told you before. So the area, this is the second L2, the area of the excursion region, then the boundary length, actually half the boundary length for some normalization region. And then before I said just the one, because we had one component, in general, it's the number of the only Poincaré characteristic, which in dimension one, in dimension two, is the number of connected components minus holes, okay? But it's a topological invariant, okay? So these are Lipschitz-Killing curvatures in dimension two, and then in higher dimension, they're further. I mean, as I said before, in general, there are the dimension plus one, and they have other geometric characterizations, okay? So Now, before I give you the first formula of this talk, I need to introduce some notation, which comes entirely from the book by Adler et Taylor in 2007. So we need to introduce first flag coefficients. Flag coefficients are just basically binomial coefficients times some constants, which comes from the measure of higher dimensional spheres, but you can think of them just as pi's and things like this. But these are universal coefficients, universal constants. And then we have these functions rho k of u. So this rho k of u are the Gaussian density, standard Gaussian density, times some Hermite polynomials, which are these polynomials that you see here. So you see a list of the first few terms. So basically, they come from further derivatives of the Gaussian distribution functions. Okay, but they are functions just of u. So let's come now to this Gaussian kinematic formula, which again, I mean, all these things you can find in the book by Taylor, Adler and Taylor. So the point is the following. This Lipschitz-Killing curve is evaluated on random sets. In principle, you should expect them to be a very complicated object, okay? Which should depend on what? On the manifold in which the field is defined. On the field, so on its coherent structure, for instance, on this. And on the threshold level that you want to consider. So you see the formula tells you the following. On the left, you have the expected value of this Lipschitz-Killing curvature, which are random object. On the right, you have their expression, which is incredibly simple and actually beautiful. Because what you have is that all the dependence on the manifold, on the threshold, decouples completely. So you have this factor here. These are just universal constants. These are the flag coefficients I was mentioning before. Then this factor here, and this factor doesn't care at all, neither about the structure of the field, nor about the manifold. These are just universal functions which depend just on the threshold. And then here you have the Lipschitz-Killing curvature, but not evaluated on the scorsion sets, which in general are very, very complicated objects, okay? But evaluated on the original manifold, which is much, much simpler, like on the original sphere. And this depends just on the manifold and on nothing else, okay? Now, at this stage, you are going to tell me this cannot be, because where is the field? I mean, something depends on the threshold, something depends on the manifold. Where is the role of the field? Well, the role of the field is really very beautiful. It's here in this superscript, okay? Because actually, this Lipschitz-Killing curvature, of course, they are geometric functionals, so they depend on the metric, the Riemannian metric that you are using. So the role of the field is simply to change the metric on which you compute these Lipschitz-Killing curvatures, both on the left and on the right side. How do you change this metric? Well, the generic idea is that the inner product between the two tangent vectors becomes equal to the expected value of the tangent vectors, of course, you know, are differential operators. So the expected value of the derivatives of the field with these differential operators. But in particular, if the field is isotropic, which is the case that we're going to study, this becomes very, very neat, because the only thing that changes is that you have to rescale the metric by what? By the square root of the covariance, the derivative of the covariance function at the origin. So this is this factor that I told before to remember. Okay, in the case of eigenfunction, is this eigenvalue divided by two, okay, squared. Okay, so the only things that matter is this fact. So for instance, if you think to the sphere, it means that you have to compute the Lipschitz-Killing curvature under a new sphere, which is the same as before, but with the radius, which depends on the covariance of the field at the origin. Egar, can you confirm me that everything is fine and you are hearing me?
Yeah, I can hear you very well.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So let's give me this one example. So for instance, so a simple application of this formula by Adler and Taylor, we did with Fricker exactly in 2016 to compute the expected value of the Lipschitz-Killing curvatures for the random eigenfunctions. So you see, it's very simple structure. So, okay, for instance, you see the, what you get is this factor here, which is just the function of u, which I mentioned here, here, and here. Then you have a function of the eigenvalue, because actually the, as I said before, the sphere is rescaled by this derivative of the covariance function at the origin. So there is this eigenvalue appearing, this power one here, one half here, and zero here. And then this four pi factor here in more terms, which basically comes from the area of this one-dimensional sphere evaluated in with the new radius. Okay, so basically this term here is the area of the sphere with the new radius. Okay, so it's extremely simple because in particular for the sphere, the Lipschitz-Skinning curve to be evaluated on the original sphere are just the area, which is 4 pi. The boundary length, which is zero, because the sphere has no boundary, and the other Poincaré characteristic, which is a topological invariant, and so it's two for the sphere, whatever is its radius. Okay. Now, so in particular, one special case of this.
Domenico, one question.
Yes, please.
One simple. So, in computing all these expectations, the main thing is to compute the Lipschitz-Skinning curvature that depends on F and the manifold. Is that correct?
The Lipschitz-Skinning curve depends on F and the manifold. Yes, but basically, I mean, if it's anisotropic, the computation is more complicated because you have to compute the Lipschitz-Skinning curve with this union Riemannian metric. But if it is isotropic, as we study, then you simply need to rescale the manifold and then use the same standard formula for the Lipschitz-Skinning curve in that manifold. So it's really trivial in some sense.
Okay.
So the formula, you know, it's not because somebody in the audience is one of the authors, but I think we can all agree that it's a truly incredibly beautiful formula. Okay. Now, one special case is if you take u equal to zero. Okay. So it's the so-called nodal case. Okay. So for instance, this gives you, in the case of the boundary length, the length of the zero set of eigenfunctions. Okay. And you get this expression here. So it's constant times square root of L. And this is important in general mathematics. Of course, it fits with the big conjecture by Yao, which is a Fields medalist, which states that actually the Hausdorff measure of the zero set of eigenfunctions should be bounded above and below by constants times the corresponding square root of corresponding eigenvalue. And this actually, Maurizio is going to tell you more about this, on not only on the sphere, but also on other manifolds, like the torus and so on. Okay, now here just by simulations done by some physicists, and you see, okay, that the formula fits very well, of course, but these arrows that you see are the fluctuations with 100 Monte Carlo replications of eigenfunctions around this. So what you want to do next, of course, these are random quantities, these Lipschitz-Skinning curves. So you want to know more about them, for instance, to study their variance and a central limit theorem under some asymptotic regime. For instance, the asymptotic regime, the so-called high frequency regime where the eigenvalue gets larger and larger, okay, which is the one of interest for most physicists. Okay, so what you see here, for instance, is one interesting fact is that the variance actually disappears. Actually, it means that it is lower order. So in the simulations, you don't see it at the zero level. And in the case, for instance, of Euler Poincaré characteristic, also at another level. Okay. So, first of all, what can we say about the variance? So, as I said, I mean, we've been working on it for quite a few years. And then in 2018, with Valentina, this Camarota, this was like the final step in a long list of research involving, as I said before, it started with Igor Wigman and then many things with Maurizio to find this expression for the fluctuations of the Lipschitz-Skinning curvatures. So these are the Lipschitz-Skinning curvatures for random eigenfunctions minus their expected value. Okay, so this is again a random quantity, and we see that this random quantity has an expression that looks very similar in some sense to the Gaussian kinematic formula. So, I mean, with some arrogance, one may think a bit of like a second order Gaussian kinematic formula, which, you know, let me say from the beginning, does not hold in general, okay? It holds, I mean, we proved it in the case of the second two-dimensional sphere and in the two-dimensional torus and other cases like this. We conjecture and we have sort of heuristic arguments to believe that it holds for general isotropic eigenfunctions on higher dimensional sphere and other manifolds, but for sure it does not hold in general for all random fields. Okay, so what is the form of this? What is the form of these fluctuations? Well, as I said before, it's sort of similar to what is was the true Gaussian kinematic formula, because we have again constant which is given by these flat coefficients. Then a function just of u, which is the derivative of the original function times the factor u. Then again, power of the eigenvalues, okay? Then this integral, sort of random measure of the sphere with the second order midpolynomial h2 of fl, okay? So in particular, notice that if you were to put here the zero order midpolynomial h0, then this would be a deterministic term and it will give you exactly the 4 pi that appears in the Gaussian kinematic formula. Okay, so this is sort of, in some sense, analogous, but integrating radiant by the zero order term, the second order Hermite polynomial. And this is not, there is a reason for this. The zero order and the two order can be explained quite clearly, and as we'll try to do in a minute. This is the two here, in a sense, strictly related to the two that appears also. And of course, once you have this expression for the fluctuations, what you have immediately also an expression for the variance, which again looks really quite rather similar, just with a square here. So some feature to be noticed. First thing important to notice is that all fluctuations for all geometric functions, all the Poincaré, boundary length, area, that just depend on a single random variable where you see only the level of the field, the original random field. So this is somewhat surprising in some sense, because you would expect second order derivatives and first order derivatives to appear by Gauss-Bonnet formula in the Euler Poincaré characteristic, but they don't, and I will try to explain why. Okay, so this is one thing. The second thing is that the same random variables appears in all functions. So this means that all functions among them in the limit, the high frequency limit where the eigenvalue goes to infinity, they are perfectly correlated. So in principle, if you know the escortion area, you know the Euler Poincaré characteristic, you know the boundary length at all levels. The other point is that if you check this expression, because there is this u term here, at u equal to zero, this expression is exactly zero. So of course the variance is not zero, but you get a lower order term. So you have this cancellation, okay? Now, so this is our—
Domenico?
Yes, please.
Just a question on that slide. The lambda L's are going to infinity as L goes to infinity?
Yes,
lambda
L is L times L plus one. So it's just L squared. You can see lambda L basically is L squared.
Like L squared?
Yes.
Okay, so they're big, okay.
So this is going to infinity, yes.
Going to infinity, yeah.
Yes, yes. This is an asymptotic result. It's not exact because there is a remainder here. So.
Okay, okay.
So,
Domenico?
Yes, please.
So what, I mean, will you also say something about the RLJ, the residual term?
Say it again?
Will you also say something about the residual term, the RLJ?
Well, the residual term, we know what's the order. Actually, we have also, in some cases, we have an explicit expression, but it's like a long series with many terms.
I see. Okay.
Okay. But I'll come to that because I'll give you a sort of clue to this. Okay.
Okay.
So just let me repeat the basic fact. So the leading terms basically are just in terms of this thing here, this H2, which is H2, remember, was x squared minus one. So basically this is the random norm of the field minus its expected value, okay? Then they are fully correlated, one with the other, okay? They are fully correlated at different levels, U1 and U2. And at U equal to zero, this variance disappears, okay? So one thing to say about these last two points. So the disappearance at U equal to zero, I mean, is the so-called Berry cancellation phenomenon, which was noted, I mean, sort of, I would say sort of heuristically, I mean, proved with the physical level of rigor by Berry and then proved rigorously by Wigman in 2010. And then, so the fact that the variance would disappear, Wigman also found the exact expression for the variance, which I'll discuss later on, and Moritz will discuss in much greater detail. And then the other thing is that there is also this correlation for the boundary length, but actually for all functions at different levels. And there is a survey by Igor after 2010, so in which he noted that in the case of boundary length, there was this correlation, okay, with different arguments. So that just let me give you a sketch of why these things are true. So let's do a special, a separate argument. Okay, assume that you have just a random variable, which is Gaussian, with normal 0, 1, okay? And then you take a nonlinear transform which has finite variance. Now, well-known fact is that this nonlinear transform, so the L2 space of finite variance nonlinear transforms of Gaussian variables admits a an orthonormal basis in terms of the Hermite polynomials. These are the same Hermite polynomials as they come in the Gaussian kinematic formula, but here it's a different issue, okay? So the point is that you can expand any nonlinear function in a Gaussian variable in terms of an orthonormal basis of Hermite polynomial times some normalizing factor and some projection coefficients, okay? Things like this, okay? So what is important to remember here? The Hermite polynomials, when you evaluate them in terms of Gaussian variables, they have a very important property, which is the so-called diagram or weak formula. Again, something which Moritz is going to discuss much better than me, but just one thing you should remember here is that if you take the covariance between two Hermite polynomials evaluated in two Gaussian variables, normalized Gaussian variables, so if they are of different order, this covariance is zero, okay? And if they are of the same order, up to this constant, the covariance is simply the power of the original covariance between the Gaussian variables, okay? Then, as I said, these Hermite polynomials span the L2 space. So what, how can you use this result to study the Hermite, the Lipschitz-Cheeney curve? Well, let's start from a very simple case. This very simple case, the simple case is the case of the excursion area. In excursion area, you can write just as the integral on the sphere of the indicator function of the random field, okay? So this takes value one if the field is above the level U and zero otherwise. Now, this indicator function clearly is a square integral random variable, a transform of the field, the Gaussian field. You can compute its projection coefficient and you get a very neat structure, which is just, you know, maybe it reminds you something, Gaussian density times the Hermite polynomial of order z, okay? So here the Hermite polynomial come in two ways. In one sense, you're expanding into Hermite polynomials. In the other sense, the Hermite polynomials also come from the coefficients. And actually these coefficients, if you look at them, they look very much similar to the rho k, which were appearing in the Gaussian kinematic formula, okay? So Gaussian density times Hermite polynomials, okay? Now, so you want to compute this area, what do you do? You compute the integral over the sphere of the expansion of the Hermite polynomial of the indicator function in terms of this Hermite polynomial. You switch the series with the integral, which you can do, and you get that the area in general is equal to what? It's a linear combination with infinite terms of these random variables HLQ, which are the integral of the Hermite polynomials computed on the sphere. So they are random quantities and the integral of this computed on the sphere. And in particular, because this is an orthonormal expansion, the variance is just the sum of the square of the projection coefficients times the variance of the single terms, this HLQ, okay? Now, the nice thing is that these single terms have a very clear behavior. The term of order zero is just the integral of H zero, so the polynomial identically equal to one on the sphere. So it gives you this 4π, which is exactly the 4π which was appearing before in the expected value, okay? Then you have a term of order one, which is the integral on the sphere of the eigenfunction. This is exactly zero. This is exactly zero because the integral of the eigenfunction is zero. Then a term of order two, which is basically the random norm minus expected value. Then term of order three, terms of order four, which are all very simple, are integral over the sphere of polynomials, okay? Now, the very important thing is that due to the covariance structure of this eigenfunction, what happens, okay, by the diagram formula I was mentioned before, then you would have just the integral of this Deschamps polynomial. Okay, this is something that Moritz is going to do in much more detail than me, but the take home message that you should simply remember is the following, that in the variance of this HLQ, there is a phase transition. So the variance of the term of order one is identically zero because the term is zero. The variance of the term of order two behaves like one over n. So it's the largest. Then the second largest is the variance of the term of order four, which is one over a square times log n. And then all the others are of order one over a square, okay? Now, so when you do, for instance, the expansion of the area, what you get is that the expansion of all the terms, but the second order terms is going to be dominating, and all the others, for instance, this is the four order terms, all the others are of smaller order. So the fluctuations are dominated by just the second order term. So So the expected value is the zero order term, and it would give it's the one given by the Gaussian kinematic formula. Then the first order term in the fluctuation is the second order, okay? And then all the others are smaller order. Is that clear? Rigar, you still hear me?
Yeah, very much.
I have about 14 or 15 minutes yet. Do I remember correctly? Considering
yes. Yeah.
Okay, fine. Now, so point is, this is for the area which is simple, okay? Now, what about the other Lipschitz-Killing curvatures? Well, the other Lipschitz-Killing curvatures by, differential geometry, you can write them as integral functions, not only of the level, but also of other. For instance, the boundary length, you can write as the integral over the sphere of, this formally some delta function, and then some gradient here. Then Gauss-Bonnet, you can write some, the Euler-Poincaré characteristic as the integral Gauss-Bonnet, Katz-Rice, if you want, no? As the integral in the sphere of the determinant of the Hessian, the gradient, and the level. So in principle, you can run the same argument, but now you need to do the Hermite expansion, not only in terms of the level, but also in terms of the gradient and the Hessian, okay? These terms are all of the same order. So it's not that one term is larger than the other. They're all of the same order. But, and this Maurizio will explain again much better with more detail than me, there is some sort of marvelous integration by part, marvelous, nice, integration by part and cancellation phenomena, so that all these expressions that in principle would be in terms of the Hessian gradient and the level, in the end you can write all of them just in terms of the level, and so you get the expression that we had before, okay? So, one natural question, so this is not a foolproof, but it was just to give you an idea, of course. One natural question that you could ask at this stage is that, is this true just for Lipschitz-Killing curvatures or for other functions? So which other functions? Natural question could be, given that we were talking about the Euler-Poincaré characteristic and Katz-Rice, what about general critical points, minima, maxima, without the Euler-Poincaré characteristic? So here, for instance, the expected value was computed by Camarota, myself, and Igor Wigman in 2016, and then the variance in the same paper. And again, we got something which looked sort of similar to Gaussian kinematic formula, no? Because it's something which is function just of mu, and then some power of the eigenvalue, which remember, this is lambda L squared divided by 4. This is exactly the square of the covariance function at the origin, okay? Then some function, again, which is just depends on the field, okay? So again, for the critical values, more recently with Valentina Camarota, we proved the same result for the critical value of the random eigenfunction. So if you look at the fluctuations of the critical values with respect to the expected value, you get a function, a term just in the eigenvalue, a deterministic term just in the threshold U, and then the same random variable as before, the integral over the sphere of H2 over F, okay? So that, in particular, what happens is that there is perfect correlation between the critical points and the Lipschitz-Killing curvature. If you know in the high frequency limit as that goes to infinity, if you know one Lipschitz-Killing curvature, you can predict the critical values, the other Lipschitz-Killing curvature, also at different levels, different thresholds. And actually, we have, with the physicists, the paper of simulations on this, and it works. You actually get even simulations, the possibility to predict these functions with great precision, okay? Now, the further point is, can I prove not only, the variance, but also a central limit theorem in the high frequency limit? So here it comes, this very successful approach, which has been introduced by Nurten and Peccati in the last decade, so-called time-Mallevin approach, which in short tells you the following. So assume you have a random variable which lives in a Wiener class, basically, which is a linear combination of Hermite polynomial over Gaussian variables, okay? Then, in order to check not only that the central limit theorem holds, but that the quantity central limit theorem holds, that means that not only you prove asymptotic Gaussianity, but you also measure the speed of convergence in some probability metric like Bassistine distance or total variation distance between your random variables and the limit. So in order to have this quantity central limit theorem, it is necessary and sufficient to look at the distance between the fourth order moment of your process and the number three after normalization. So if and only if your for, the fourth order moment of your sequence of random variables goes to 3, you have a set limit theorem, and to measure quantitatively the distance with the Gaussian, it's enough that you measure the distance between the fourth order moment and 3. Now, because these random variables, the leading term lives in the Gaussian chaos, then we can apply this result. And so we can prove for this Lipschitz-Kinney curvature not only center limit theorem, but quantity center limit theorem in vast extent distance. Okay? And then, so we can also see the speed with which the Gaussian approximation holds. Okay, so these are the theorems, so the Lipschitz-Kinney curvature, minor expected value normalized by the square root of the variance. They converge to a Gaussian, and the distance, but the vast extent distance between the limit Gaussian law and this is of order L minus one. Okay, now here I come to my to our high dimensional conjecture.
Domenico?
Yes, please.
So in the previous result,
yes.
So it is univariate central limit theorem. So if you also have several levels, U1, U2.
Yeah, for several levels it works as well. But several levels is actually trivial in this case because several levels are
exactly because correlation.
So it's there is a single random variable.
Right. So you will prove degenerate.
Yes, as many as you want.
I see.
Non-zero levels.
Eh? Yeah, I understand. Okay.
Okay. So in case there is something young and ambitious in the audience, so that's what I said before. So this is for the two-dimensional sphere. We have a similar proof for the two-dimensional torus. What happens in general? So if you look at the general random field, the result is not true. This we know. But if you look, for instance, on eigenfunctions on different manifolds, for instance, on the higher dimensional field, is this true? Well, I believe it is. And we have a sort of a sketch heuristic argument, but not a proof. So if somebody wants a topic to try to prove, I just keep. So in the higher dimensional case, you have an higher dimensional Laplacian Helmholtz equation. It's known therefore the eigenvalue, the form that it takes. It's so the derivative at the origin is this. It's the derivative divided, the eigenvalue divided by this. The dimension of the eigenspace is also known. So you have a field with mean zero, variance one, this covariance. So the conjecture is the following, that the Lipschitz-Kinney curve minus its expected value is equal to minus 1/2. This comes because it's the second order chaos which is dominating. Same flag coefficients. This expression u r prime is the same. Then you see here the derivative of the covariance function at the origin. So it's the eigenvalue divided by d to the value's power. And then the integral of h2 of this field over the sphere plus the lower order term of this value. So this is the conjecture. And all the other things we hold as well, the variances on the things as well. As I said, there is a sort of sketched proof, but with big gaps, which it's not clear at all that are easy to fill. So I'm pretty sure the result is true, but it's not true. Okay, now, so what about...
Sorry, just a question about the previous slide, Domenico.
Yes.
So there is nothing D going
to the referee is stopping time. Huh?
Sorry. No, there is no D going to infinity in all this, right? You are just
No. This fixes this.
Okay.
In fact, actually, this is what you mentioned is an extremely interesting research topic with, I believe, important applications in machine learning, where they use a lot D going to infinity, random spheres with D going to infinity. But that's a different issue. In fact, actually, this I think is another very interesting research area. So what happens with D going to infinity? To be honest, we have been thinking about that as well, but we didn't get much so far. Okay?
Thanks.
But I think it's a very interesting issue. I think it's in my, not in my program, but in my hopes, it's in my to-do list. But more hope than program. Okay? Okay, now, all this happens at u different from zero. What happens at u equal to zero? At u equal to zero, the second order term disappears. And there is also heuristic for all Lipschitz-Kinney curves. Okay, and there is a heuristic reason for that because this second order term is proportional to fluctuations in the random norm of the field. And of course, all the quantities which are at u equal to zero, they don't see the fluctuations in the norm. Okay, because they are invariant in the norm of the field. The statistic, the geometric features computed at u equal to zero. You could normalize the norm to one and the behavior at u equal to zero wouldn't change. So the second order chaos disappears. In the case of the area, also the fourth order chaos disappears and you have to study all chaoses together. Still, you can study the variance. Still, you can get the central limit theorem and with other arguments. limits, okay? And the quantity is simply limited as well. So the idea of the proof is again, you have all terms, so all these H2 here, but for each of them, you can prove a quantity centered limit theorem. Then what you do is you take M of these elements, you prove fixed, you prove a centered limit theorem with N elements, and then because M, you can take as large as you want, the remainder is negligible and you get the full centered limit theorem. But the area at level u equal to zero leaves on all odd order counts. So 3, 5, 7, 9, all together. What happens for the nodal length? Now, here is just a small spoiler for the talk of Maurizio. So what happens in short, as I said before, it was Igor Wigman who found the correct expression for the variance in some 10 years ago. But here there is this log. Now, if you remember, when we mentioned the variances of the causes, for the fourth order causes, there was a log term appearing. So it was very natural to conjecture. Will it be the case that you have this log in the variance because the nodal lines are dominated by the fourth order cause? And the answer is yes, okay? So this is again what Maurizio is going to discuss. What you can prove is that the fluctuations at the zero level of the nodal length minus its expected value are dominated by the fourth order cause. So where you had before 1/2, now you have 1/4 factorial, again square root of the eigenvalue, then smaller order term. Now this is something which is actually more general than the sphere, also from the torus, on the plane, but this is also in the talk by Maurizio. Okay, now next question is, what about correlation between zero level and non-zero level, okay? So the take home message of what I said so far is that non-zero level is dominated by the second order counts. The zero level is dominated by the fourth counts. So these are orthogonal expansions. So you expect the correlation to be zero, and it is exactly zero. So if you look at the correlation between the nodal length, so the length at level zero, and the non-zero boundary length, then this correlation is zero. But one could say, well, that's true, it was expected and you can prove it, but this also is due to the fact that the boundary length at non-zero level is dominated by the norm of the function. What happens if we take away this effect? So we sort of normalize the eigenfunctions to have the same norm. So if you consider the boundary length at non-zero level and take away the effect of the fluctuations in the norm, so you sort of normalize the norm of the eigenfunction, then also at non-zero level, you have full correlation. You have that the boundary length is dominated by single cause, which is the fourth, and so you have full correlation between nodal length and boundary length. So if you know the length of the eigenfunctions at zero level, you can predict the length of the eigenfunctions at all level, provided you take away the effect of the random norm, okay? Sort of normalized. Okay, so the nodal length predicts all the other levels, okay?
Domenico, could you please repeat that normalization?
This is a bit cheating because it's not a normalization. Because if you normalize, so you divide by the norm,
exactly,
you get something which is outside the chaos and becomes complicated. So what we did is not really to normalize, but to study what is known as the partial correlation. So you take the residuals from the boundary length when you subtract the effect of the random norm, like you do residuals in statistics. Mm-hmm. And then you correlate these residuals with the nodal length. And this is perfectly correlated, the correlation is one. In fact, if you want, this is one more interesting issue for somebody who wants a topic for research. So rather than doing this, so this partial correlation, divide by the random norm, and you know, I very much expected the same result would hold. But technically, it's more difficult to study because if you divide by the random norm, you are no longer in the chaos. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I expect the same result that the normalization by the norm is full correlation, but to prove it technically is more complicated. Okay. So, in particular, taking away this effect of the random norm, again, the boundary length at any level has this expression, the integral of H4 times this deterministic function. Now, does something, 2 minutes and I finish, okay? Something similar for the critical points? The answer is yes. So Valentina Gambarotta and Digger Wigman in 2019, they found the leading term, the expression for the variances of the the total number of critical points. By symmetry, this is the same as the number of critical points above zero, like the number of maxima above zero is the same as the total, twice or half, one half of the total number. So again, they found the log. So the obvious idea is, why do we have this log? Is it going to be that it's going to be nominated by the fourth chaos? And again, the answer is yes. And again, very nicely, it turns out that this is the fourth order chaos computed just on the level. So to predict the total number of critical points, it's enough if you know the integral of the fourth Hermite polynomial evaluated on the random field without looking at its gradient and derivative. If you give me just the integral of the fourth power of the Hermite polynomial of the random field, then I can predict with probability one, I mean correlation one, in the high frequency limit, the number of maxima that this field is going to have in the case of random eigen functions. Okay? And in particular, because of this, there is also perfect correlation between the total number of critical points and, for instance, the nodal length. Okay? So in the end, you get this is the my second last slide, basically. This is the bottom line. So at u equal to zero, all Lipschitz Killing curves during critical values are dominated by the second order chaos. At u equal to four, this is nodal length, as Maurizio is going to discuss, and critical points are dominated by this fourth order chaos, just the integral of the fourth power of FL, okay? Then if you control for the boundary, then also at non-zero levels, the boundary length is dominated by this fourth order chaos. The area is different because it lives on all odd order chaos. Okay? So you get this sort of asymptotic correlation tables where you see correlate between these are the various Lipschitz-Killing curvature, the zero level boundary length, the corrected boundary length at non-zero level, the critical points. There is all this correlation which are one or zeros, and then you can actually check on simulations. Well, you know, those at non-zero levels at simulations fit very well. Those are at zero level at simulations are more difficult to get because there is this log term which in simulations you know is hard to see. Okay, that's the end basically. I don't know, this is just trailer for Maurizio, analogous but not equivalent reduction principles on other manifolds, arithmetic random waves on the torus, on the plane, very random waves. This is all going to be discussed by Maurizio. Then some analogous behavior in space at Adna Paola Torino was my PhD student. So she proved some analogous results on subsets of the sphere, so field defined on subsets. And then what's in the future? So we are trying to do similar things for random fields which with more complicated but also strongly motivated from physics geometric structure. So in particular on random sections of fiber bundles, so called spin random fields, which again they come from cosmic background or cosmological analysis. And what we also been doing, we have already a paper on this on nanosupply probability last year, and we're going to keep working on this. We have some related results, not for random eigenfunctions, but for random fields on sphere cross time. Okay. And in that case as well, you can prove that under some circumstances, the fluctuations of the Lipschitz-Killing curvature are dominated by a single chaos term, which we write down explicitly. And this we did for this Scorchian area. Now we are doing it for the boundary length and for the order quantity characteristic again with Maurizio Rossi, Anna Vidotto, and Valentina Camarota. Okay, so that's it. For sure I finished my time, but I don't think I went too much over time taking into account the various interruptions.
No, you ended on this one spot. Okay, so maybe we all can unmute for a while. Is it possible, Yogeshwar?
Yes.
Just to, say thank you.
Okay. So maybe should I stop my screen or you need to see my slide again?
I guess it is better to keep the screen share on if anybody wants to point their question to a particular slide. So if there are any questions, you may please unmute and ask.
I have one, Domenico. This is Manjunath. Can you hear? I had a question. So this.
I don't know who is speaking, but I can hear you.
Oh, sorry. This is Manjunath.
Hi.
Yeah. So I had this question about, so if you add two independent random fields, Gaussian random fields, it looks like the expected Lipschitz curvature of the excursion sets add. Is that correct?
So if the sets at the so these are two Gaussian isotropic random fields. Yeah, in the end, it's just the covariance, if the covariance function adds, yes.
Because I mean, this is something
it's on the same end. The expected value, you mean the expected
value. Of the excursions. This is not something intuitively clear, right? Or for example, it's not true for is it?
So how was this done? If you so you take two fields and that's not true because it's what happens is that you get a new field which has a covariance which is the sum of the two covariance. I agree. So the new Riemannian metric is defined out of this covariance, but then these expressions, they're not linear. So it's the two covariances that add, I agree, but the expressions that you get even for the expected value, that's not linear, no?
Oh, it's not? I mean, you mean that the GF of X...
You're talking about random fields in general or about the random eigenfunctions, as it is the case here?
I was talking in general. You had this slide where you had this GF, right? The Riemannian metric defined.
Okay,
maybe I mistook. So is that additive if you add two fields?
The point is that this I agree, okay? But the point is that then in the expected value, what you have to do is you have to compute this thing here with this new metric, okay?
Uh-huh.
And this in general is a highly nonlinear operation.
Okay.
So I agree with you. There is also take into account that you have to renormalize the fields to have variance one, okay? But I agree with you that the two covariances, they just add, okay?
Uh-huh.
So in this sense, the metric tensor, you can see as the sum of the two. This I agree, okay? But then when you have to compute these things here, these are two highly nonlinear and complicated functions. So it's the story is more complicated, okay?
Okay. So one reason I asked, I mean, your interest in this, when you mentioned the CMB and so on, you did not want a particular FL, but a linear combination of those things. So can you also do all your calculations for that? I mean, with some appropriate coefficients, I don't know what is appropriate, but, or do you need a single L for your second order?
Do you mean if we can do this on real cosmological fields?
No, I mean, with the spherical one, but not for a fixed L, but for a linear combination of FL, right? I mean, you wanted...
So the point is the following. You cannot get the Lipschitz-Killing curvature by the expressions on the Lipschitz-Killing curvature for the single eigenfunctions. However, the expected value of the Lipschitz-Killing curvature on the whole field, you can easily get by the Gaussian kinematic formula, okay?
Uh-huh.
Then in principle, if you want to use these results to do data analysis on cosmology, then what you can do is you take the random field, the observed random field on the sphere, decomposing this into these Fourier modes, into the single eigenfunctions, okay? Uh-huh. And then check L by L, eigenfunction by eigenfunction, whether the Lipschitz-Killing curvature fit your predictions or not, okay?
Uh-huh.
Now, this exact thing cannot be done, but something similar has been done, and it is in fact inside the CMB papers, okay? So this cannot be done. Why? Just one technical point is that in real data, you cannot really compute the exact eigenfunctions because you have gaps in the maps. There are parts of the sphere that you cannot observe. And then you cannot do exact Fourier transforms, okay? So you cannot really use the exact result on the single eigenfunction. However, what you can observe, what you can compute, are some like narrow band linear combinations of eigenfunctions, okay?
Uh-huh.
So averages of nearby eigenfunctions. So on this, actually, we did both the expected value and the variance, and we did also the application for real data.
I see.
These sort of things can be applied on real data, not exactly the things that I discussed today, because they are on singular eigenfunctions, which, you know, I mean, in principle, according to somebody, you can even reconstruct the missing regions, but most physicists would not accept it. They wouldn't consider it reliable. So on the single eigenfunctions in practice, be unfeasible in practice. But on averages of eigenfunctions, so-called needlets and so on, it can be done, and it has been done on real data. It is in, the, in this big collaboration that this has been done on real data.
Oh, okay. Very nice. Thanks.
Any more questions? Domenico, could you quickly go to the critical points slide?
Which one? Total critical
points? No, no, no. The expected value minus the fluctuations.
Yeah, but there are two fluctuations. No,
just go on. Stop. Next. Yeah, here, this one. So the G2 over here and the G3 that appears on the next slide. G1 and G2, sorry. So in the usual kinematic fundamental formula, there was this nice interpretation of the rho case that basically they were related. That is correct. So there is no such interpretation over here, is it?
Maybe there is, but I didn't find it.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, there could be. Probably there is, but I wasn't able to find it. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were not able to find it.
Uh-huh. Very nice talk. So if there are no more questions, perhaps we can take a break and we will reconvene for the next talk. Yogesh, let's say in 10